You and peace, all of everyone, from God our Father and the Lord, who is Jesus the Christ. It's good to be together in church for a Sunday morning. We've shared our joys and concerns and our announcements, looking ahead. Meetings for the week will be canceled and rescheduled as a result of the passing of our sister Trish Lewis. Prelude. Looking to the bulletin, would you join me with the bold in the words of gathering and then together in unison to the prayer of confession to follow. The voice of wisdom calls to us from the street corner, the grocery store aisle, the noisy dinner table, and the quiet places of our hearts. Will you listen?
Yes.
Wisdom calls to us with hard truths, showing us where we've strayed in our hearts and as a community and urging us back into God's path. Will you follow?
Yes.
Wisdom's call persists through the twists and turns, the rough patches, the barely discernible paths forward, and the moments we feel completely lost. Will you hold on to wisdom wherever she takes you? Then, beloved, let us worship God together. Let's pray together. We long for wisdom, O Lord, but prefer that it be our own. We turn away from the ideas of others and ignore the possibility and promise that come from life together with you. Most of all, we drown out your gift of wisdom as she seeks to get our attention, for we believe that we know better or would prefer to decide where we make her welcome. Forgive us, loving God. Bring an end to the self-righteousness that ignores you, and awaken us anew to the wisdom that comes only from you. Show us how to walk in your ways and listen to your promise each and every day. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with me as we look to our hymnal on page 568, Christ for the World, We Sing. Seated. Let's look to the words of assurance in the bulletin. With gentleness, God speaks to us. With graciousness, God forgives us. With joy, God embraces us. With our lips, we praise God. With our words, we thank you. With our silence, we find God in our hearts. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hymnals to page 92. We would like you to join us on verse 4 for the beauty of the earth. Mr. Mike.
Thank you, choir. For our readings. The first from the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah, words of paying attention and giving response to God's love for us. And then our response to that reading, we join with the generations in the reciting and the reading and hearing of the Psalms, something that God's people have been doing for thousands of years. We join that cloud of witnesses in the reciting of the Psalm.
Isaiah 50. 4-9, the Common English Bible. God's faithful servant. The Lord God gave me an educated tongue to know how to respond to the weary with a word that will awaken them in the morning. God awakens my ear in the morning to listen, as educated people do. The Lord God opened my ear. I didn't rebel. I didn't turn my back. Instead, I gave my body to attackers and my cheeks to bearded pluckers. I didn't hide my face from insults and spitting. The Lord God will help me. Therefore, I haven't been insulted. Therefore, I set my face like flint and knew I wouldn't be ashamed. The one who will declare me innocent is near. Who will argue with me? Let's stand up together. Who will bring judgment against me? Let him approach me. Look, the Lord God will help me. Who will condemn me? Look, they will wear out like clothing. The moth will eat them. Response 837. Psalm 116. I love the Lord who has heard my voice and my supplications and has inclined his ear to me whenever I call. The snares of death encompass me. The pangs of Sheol lay on me. I suffer distress and anguish. Then I called out the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beseech you, save my life. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is merciful. The Lord preserves the simple. When I was brought low, the Lord saved me. Return, O my soul, to your rest. For the Lord has dealt bountifully with me. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. I walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I kept my faith, even when I said, I am greatly afflicted. I said, all humans are vain hope. What shall I return to the Lord for all my benefits? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of the faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant, the child of your handmaid. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord.
Amen. Our gospel reading for the day is from the Good News of Jesus Christ according to St. Mark, the 8th chapter, beginning the 27th. Jesus and his disciples went into the villages near Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" They told him, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." He, Jesus, asked them, "And what about you? Who do you say that I am?" Peter answered, "You are the Christ." Jesus ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then Jesus began to teach his disciples, "The human one must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and the legal experts and be killed, and then after 3 days, rise from the dead." He said this plainly. But Peter took hold of Jesus and, scolding him, began to correct him. Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, then sternly corrected Peter. "Get behind me, Satan. You are not thinking God's thoughts, but human thoughts." After calling the crowd together with his disciples, Jesus said to them, "All who want to come after me must say no to themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. All who want to save their lives will lose them, but all those who lose their lives because of me and because of the good news will save them. Why would people gain the whole world but lose their lives? What will people give in exchange for their lives? Whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this unfaithful and sinful generation, the human one will be ashamed of that person when he comes into the Father's glory and with the holy angels." The word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Have you ever known someone who seemed to wander around in the dark most of the time? My dad once spoke of someone who appeared lost in thought and unable to find their way back. Those folks are not really lost, but they may lack a measure of clarity. That's really what we're talking about, and the feeling is familiar to many of us as well. I once heard that state called wool gathering. The phrase caught my attention, and I had to look up where it came from. In a writing somewhere back in the mid-1500s, there were people who would follow a flock of sheep and pick tufts of wool from bushes and brambles, saving what they gathered for sale at a later time. It was not hard work, nor was it very profitable. Those who wandered about scrounging the bits and tufts of wool often got sidetracked with other interests. They were daydreaming. And that's the central meaning of wool gathering. They were lost in thought, going through the motions of being productive, but not paying attention to what was going on around them. One good, well-placed comment or question would usually bring people back into focus, leading folks to more productive work. The disciples were used to being with Jesus by this time. Mark places this event well past the middle of the earthly ministry of Jesus. Maybe they were comfortable with what Jesus was doing. It's hard to imagine that, but traveling together with Jesus, they'd been present for most of what he'd done by now. They'd seen a number of what we call miracles, both feeding the crowds and creating healing in weakened bodies. They listened to what it was Jesus was teaching crowds that gathered and sat as a smaller group when his wisdom was being shared with only the 12. It's likely they had watched and listened when their rabbi had conversations with Roman officials. Certainly, they'd attended any number of community gatherings and synagogues around the countryside where he read and taught from the scriptures and the laws of Moses. Perhaps they were so used to being in his presence that they had grown comfortable, accustomed to the remarkable opportunity they had as his disciples. We really don't know, because the Gospels do not often provide us a full context for what was going on when small reports and stories are written and shared like these for us today. Mark reports the group was headed north towards Caesarea, one of the larger cities on the edge of the Sea of Galilee, and the home of Peter's family, offered for their regular use when they were in the area. As they neared their destination, Jesus began a conversation asking about his reputation in the places they'd been. You know the list. Some thought John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin, who'd been recently executed by Herod's troops. He'd been beheaded. Others had other opinions, even the presence of the ancient prophets, even Elijah, the one they waited for and set an empty chair for at the end of every Passover. These were safe questions and fairly mild conversation while the teacher and his disciples were heading toward another one of his events. And they, the disciples, reported the list, the things that they'd heard. No more than rumors, some of them, and others, perhaps serious questioning by deeply searching souls. So far, their answers needed little thought, and certainly no deep thought. Perhaps they were doing what would later be called wool gathering. But then, when the answers were simple reports of the thoughts of men and women from the many crowds where Jesus had been present, he asked the disciples directly, "But who do you say I am?" Had they thought about that? Nights around a fire at an inn, or in the countryside, a rough camp, or along a waterway, a fishing village, a lake. Had the question been raised among the 12 themselves? There is no indication that they had, but it seems there must have been thoughts in their own minds somehow, perhaps a few short comments as they processed their experiences after a day of listening to one of Jesus' teaching messages, or when a healing happened with his touch to a beggar, a blind man, an outcast leper. It was Peter, the disciple who had left the boat at Jesus' invitation to walk on the water, then promptly sank below the surface, who spoke. He'd been drawn from the waves by Jesus himself, returning to the boat at that time. That Peter, whose faith was insufficient to walk without our Lord's assistance. It was that Peter who named Jesus as the Christ, the Son of the living God. As faithful and practicing Jews, the Messiah referenced in scriptures was not a name, but a Savior known from their faith who would rescue God's people and return to them a closeness that had been lost for generations. Peter, as doubt as any of the community, spoke with confidence, naming Jesus as the Messiah of the Jews, known in the Greek, not as Messiah, a Hebrew phrase, but as Christ, a Greek word, naming that figure from prophecy and anticipation for generations from the Old Testament. "You," Peter declares without hesitation, "you are the Christ." Today we join the two together as Jesus Christ, almost as if the second is a last name. For Peter and the rest, that was far from their understanding. Before them stood their teacher, the one who had called them to be his followers and students not that long before. A few months, a couple years. The things they'd seen and experienced by then were so comfortably present in those weeks and months that they may have lost track of what they had access to. They may have become used to miracles and teachings, sermons and prayers, meals together with their own band, and other times in large homes of the wealthy and influential of their country. They may have become so used to these things that they lost track of what was going on right in front of them. Peter gained focus first. It was he who spoke those words of amazement and of faith. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. After that, nothing would matter more. It's a good question, one we need to spend some time with on our own. Who do we say Jesus is? What and who is Jesus to us? Do we know enough to take a stand, to declare with conviction an answer that defines Jesus in our lives and in turn defines our relationship with him? Have we become so lost in habitual thought and habitual practice and habitual worship that we, like Peter, need to be awakened by the abruptness of that question? Jesus speaks through history from that moment and even today to us. That question, who do you say I am? And there's a question for us, not just in church on a Sunday morning, but for every day. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, you know when we wander in our thoughts. You know when we wander in other places too, and our complacency becomes the pattern of our lives. You know that because you know us better than we know ourselves. Every once in a while, we need to be brought back to the center, back to the basics. And in this moment, and in this morning, you ask us to say for ourselves who you are to us. Help us answer with clarity and understanding for ourselves, for you, and for the community that we call ourselves part of, this community of Christians. Be with us, guide, guard, and keep us along the way. And God's people say, amen. If you look to our small hymnal, the small black paperback, The Faith We Sing, if you'd stand with me as you are able for 2130, The Summons.
Never be the same.
may be seated. Abraham Lincoln was working deeply with the Civil War, and during that time, during the meetings of his cabinet officials, he would always have someone close their meetings in prayer. One of his cabinet members one day closed with prayer, ending, asking, petitioning God to be on their side. Lincoln stopped at that point in the middle of that time of contention and division in the nation's spirit, acknowledged what had been said, and said, "Rather, let us pray that we are on God's side." This has been a particularly challenging week in our nation's experience with the broadcast debate between candidates for the highest office. There's a lot of rhetoric going around right now, looking to gain political points by mounting one's own value or by denigrating someone else. Those experiences are ones of division. And I think it appropriate for us to name that as part of what our experience is, sometimes not just as a nation, but even within our own community and sometimes within our own homes. We are close to being polarized with the opposite voices of the issues and the people. And there is nothing about that that is healthy or constructive. The first of my prayers this morning addresses that. We will include at the end what I call a bidding prayer, what our church teaches us as a bidding prayer, where we invite prayers and thoughts about a number of different groups of people and thoughts. Would you join me in prayer? Lord God, as our national election approaches, we seek to better understand the issues and concerns that confront our country and how the gospel compels us to respond as faithful citizens in our community. We ask for eyes that are free from blindness, so we might see each other as brothers and sisters, one and equal in dignity, especially those who are victims of abuse and violence, deceit and poverty. We ask for ears that will hear the cries of children unborn and those abandoned, men and women oppressed because of race or creed, religion or gender. We ask for minds and hearts that are open to hearing the voice of leaders who will bring us closer to your kingdom. We pray for discernment so we may choose leaders who hear your word, live your love, and keep in the ways of your truth as they follow in the steps of Jesus and his apostles and guide us to your kingdom of justice and peace. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and through the power and work of your Holy Spirit. We pray also this morning for our pastors and bishops, that they may hear your call and faithfully lead your people. We pray for our church, that it may be reformed and renewed. We pray for victims of abuse, that Christ the Savior may be close to each of them. For migrants who seek safety from war and terror, that they receive love and care. For homeless families and children, that their needs may be remembered. For all of us, as we begin a new week, that we may learn to live each day according to your guidance, that our prayers, spoken and silent, may be heard through your Holy Spirit. And lastly, we pray for the dead, especially this morning for Trish, that she may walk in the presence of you, our Lord. Lord, hear us. God of all compassion, you protect your people in every difficulty. Hear our prayers and grant us your grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who teaches us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. An offering is not simply something to support the work of the church. It is an act of worship. It's a bringing to this place and this time a portion of our energies, our attention, our focus, our skills, our gifts, our sweat and tears, and making a portion of all of that through our offering available to Almighty God, joining together with others that do the same thing for the work of bringing the kingdom into focus and reality in the here and now. The time for our offering is with us this morning.
Thank you.
Join me in the printed doxology from the bulletin. Let's pray. Divine source of wisdom, we bring these offerings with hearts attuned to your call. As we gather in your presence, may our gifts reflect the wisdom and discernment you desire for us. Use these offerings to nurture understanding, compassion, and justice in our world. Guide us to listen and act with insight, spreading your love and grace. Transform our giving into actions that make a difference. Help us grow in our faith and commitment to your ways. In the holy name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. And looking to our hymnal again, let's stand as you are able. Join 159, lift high the cross. Looking to the bulletin again and the benediction responsively, please join me. Go now with God. Go now with Christ our Lord. Go now with the Spirit. Go, knowing that God will direct your path. Folks, you are loved by God. You are cared for by the divine himself. There is a special work for you in the world, else why would you be inside this creation? Your life, in the eyes and face of God, has a sacred purpose and value. Receive this blessing in the name of Almighty God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Go to love and to serve in all that you do. Amen.